I can't wait for Christmas Day because Robert Downey Jr.'s latest film, Sherlock Holmes, is coming. Now, I've been raised on the late 19th century British detective created by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. I've read some of the stories, I saw a play version, and I've seen episodes of the Jeremy Brett show from the late 80s into the 90s. My mom had those and we used to watch them together. And I've also seen other actors go through the role, including Peter Cushing, Arthur Wontner, and Ronald Howard, but I'm going to talk about what many people consider to be the screen Sherlock Holmes, Basil Rathbone. He played the role from 1939 until 1946 in 14 films. Now, rather than review every single film, which I won't do because one, I don't think you'll be able to sit through it. Two, it would be boring. Three, I don't have time to watch every single film. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a little bit of a behind the scenes of the films, and I'm also going to do a top five list of the films that I would recommend to viewers. Now, before being cast as Sherlock Holmes, Basil Rathbone usually played the villains that usually lost during sword fights in such films as The Adventures of Robin Hood and Captain Blood. So being cast as Sherlock Holmes, the hero, was in a way kind of like being cast against type. And to play Holmes' assistant, Dr. Watson, was Nigel Bruce. Now, Bruce's characterization as an old idiot who is constantly getting into trouble or making stupid mistakes can sometimes be frustrating with the viewers. But I think this was done for two reasons. One, I think the studio was trying to have the teaming of Sherlock Holmes and Watson be modeled on after comedy teams from that time, especially ones where one person is the smart one and the other is the dumb one, kind of like Laurel and Hardy or Abbott and Costello. And two, my mom pointed this out to me too, they did it so that Holmes would look smarter, especially in cases where the clues were very easy to solve. The first two films were made in 1939 by 20th Century Fox and were the only ones to be set in the late 1890s. The Hound of the Baskervilles, which is pretty much the only straight adaptation, and The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes. And in these films, Watson is not as dumb as he would be later in the series. The first one was originally meant to be just a one-off film, but because it was very successful, the second film was rushed into production. But afterwards, the studio decided not to make any more Holmes films. But in 1942, Universal took over the series, and several changes took place. For example, the films were now set in what was then the present, with Holmes being more of a contemporary figure. And the first three films dealt with the war, including Holmes often fighting Nazi spies. And many people wonder why the time was changed for this. Well, for one, Universal was not really the most expensive studio on the block. They didn't really have the money to make films that were set in the past, except for probably westerns. Second, these films were cheap B-pictures. And third, almost a lot of stars at the time were making films related to the war to keep Americans' morale up, including Bob Hope, Laurel and Hardy, The Three Stooges, and cartoon characters like Bugs Bunny and Donald Duck. So why not Sherlock Holmes? Now, the first three films, beginning with The Voice of Terror, has Holmes fighting German spies. But in the fourth film, the films kind of moved away from that, thankfully. But they were still set in the 1940s. The films were very popular with audiences because they were very engaging, atmospheric, and very interesting. But Rathbone felt that the Holmes films had cost him some work because of his association with the character. So he decided not to renew his contract. And although he continued to work after that, audiences and at that time just kept remembering him for his Holmes work. Now, luckily, all 14 Rathbone films are now on DVD in different types of sets. MPI Video has released all 14 films digitally remastered with clear picture, sound, and those are probably the best versions to get. Now, the first set one is called The Complete Collection. It has all 14 films, and the 12 Universal Pictures are available on DVD in three sets, each one containing four different films, and the two Fox films are available on their own. Four of the films are in the public domain, which means that cheap DVD companies have these bad prints where there's those dirt specks and lines in the picture. The picture's a little cloudy and hard to see, and there might be these muddled crackles in the soundtrack. The MPI DVDs are definitely the best versions out there. I think they're the closest to how the audiences might have seen them in the theaters. And they are the ones that I recommend renting. Okay, now on to my top five list. Now, while I do recommend watching all 14 films, I know many of you may not do that, and some would rather just sample one or two films to get an idea of what there are. So what I did was I picked the five films that I think are the best in the series, and I'm going to do them in the order that they were released. So if you want to see the complete list of the films, you can check on the internet to see what they were. Okay, number one, The Hound of the Baskervilles. It's probably one of the more slower entries in this series, but I think it did get the series off to a great start. Now, while I don't think this is the best version of the story, I think for the most part it's very well shot. It displays a great moody atmosphere, especially on the moor sets, and it's got a great looking production value to it, and it's got an excellent cast too, like Lionel Atwill and John Carradine, who popped up in a lot of horror films from this period. And if there's problems with this film, it's probably because there were some changes done to the story. Number two, The Adventures of Sherlock Holmes, which I think is a little bit better than The Hound. For example, it's better paced, and it's the first film to feature Sherlock Holmes' most famous enemy, Professor Moriarty, who is played by George Zucco here. In the scenes they have together, they have these great exchanges. But the big problems I saw with this film was that the film's female victim, played by Ida Lupino, she seems a little bit stiff, and she looks like she doesn't want to be there, and there are some plot holes in this movie. But also, there isn't much of a mystery, because Moriarty, early on in the movie, tells Holmes what he plans to do to him. But if I had to recommend a Holmes film that was set in the 1890s, I would probably recommend this one of the two. Number three, Sherlock Holmes Faces Death. Watson is not so incompetent as he was earlier in the World War II films, and what impressed me here was the black and white photography, especially the ones that are in dark rooms where you see these shadows on the actors' faces, and the camera work in this film I think is probably one of the best that I've seen in these Rathbone films. The characters I found very interesting, and some of them could have been very interesting suspects, very excellent ones, as a matter of fact. The story is not the film's strong point, and people might not be interested in Holmes' final speech at the end, but it's definitely one of the best of these 1940s films. Number four, The Scarlet Claw. Many fans say that this is probably the best film in the whole series, and while it is good, I think there are some better entries in it. Like most of the Holmes films, Claw doesn't really have much depth, but they are meant to be fun for the audience with different twists, you know, thrown at the audience. And who could the villain be? As a matter of fact, the villain was something that I had a bit of a problem with. I think the villain turned out to be a bit flat and wooden, had a wooden way of speaking to Holmes. Alright, and number five, The House of Fear. Now this film seems kind of like a knockoff of the Agatha Christie book And Then There Were None, or Ten Little Indians, as it's also known as. In this film, someone is sending orange pips to seven retired men and killing them. Holmes thinks that the suspect is one of the people living in the homes, but is he right? The film, I thought, had a great twist I did not see coming, and that this is one of the films that I actually felt the most involved in. The sets in this film I didn't think were quite as good as the ones that were done earlier on, like, let's say, Sherlock Holmes Faces Death, but it was a great mystery. Okay, that's it for my video. Feel free to leave any comments about the video or about the Sherlock Holmes films in general, and we'll see you later.